just an exhibit of an incredible amount of Todd Rundgren memorabilia, and I love looking at it. I hate seeing things that I don't own that I want to get and don't know how to obtain, but it's incredible. There's not only copies of each album that he's recorded, but different covers of those albums and all sorts of tour programs, photographs, albums that Todd produced, albums that he engineered and or played on.
It's a great experience to be part of history of Todd's 28th album. Following him around the country on concert, and this is a totally different experience watching him record an album. Something I've always wanted to see, never got the chance.
On the wall each night they've had huge pieces of butcher paper asking questions and letting the attendees answer those questions.
Every Todd fan's dream is to be in the studio with Todd, but that's not possible, at least not until now.
Let me give you a little introductory wrappage here. I hope that it's been made clear in the press and when you bought your tickets, somebody gave you a warning that this is not a show in the traditional sense. This is a recording session. In other words, you are participating in a recording session, so we are not so much obligated to entertain you as to as you are to help us create what will ultimately be a record, we hope.
As far as the shows, I like them a lot.
The sessions.
That's right. They're not. It's not a concert. It's a session.
Let me clarify the distinction between a recording session and a show. In a show, we might we would play every song once, and no matter how bad we played it, we would play it from beginning to end, and then go on to the next song, and kind of like try and forget how badly we played it once we had done that. In this particular context, if we start playing a song badly, then we have to stop it and start it over again because there's no point in just going through the song for the exercise. We're trying to make a record.
The whole stage is completely different. Everyone's separated with plexiglass, headphones instead of monitors.
The reason why you're here is because in a normal studio setting, we would be playing the music and then that would go onto a machine, and then it would get mixed, and then 6 months later or so, the audience at large would get to hear it, and that would sort of complete the loop of performer to listener. And we wanted to sort of close up that loop so that we can feel not like we're playing to a machine, but that we're playing to people. And coincidentally, you happen to be people.
You see, Joel Selvin said that, like, even the front of house mix suffered because everything was geared towards the real audience, which was out in the truck, which in a sense is true, but I don't think that the front of house audience ever really suffered. They just didn't get quite as much as they would have had there not been a truck out back, you know, which because I can't obviously pump it as loud as I would like to and be as dynamic with the mix as I would like to because of how that's going to affect the ultimate outcome of why we're all here, and that's to make a record.
The ground rules are slightly different as well for you now being almost part of the performance. The ground rules will be different. We are not seeking to make what is commonly referred to as a live album. That is an album where you go out and you play the songs and it's just like the listener is in the audience. We want this to sound like a studio album, studio quality. That's why there's plastic all over the place and we're all using headphones and why the sound won't be deafeningly loud coming out of the PA. By the same token, we don't want the audience like hooting and hollering through the songs. And we would prefer that you waited until I give you a certain sign at the end that will signify that the master fader has been pulled down after the song is mixed, and therefore we can talk and make noise and stuff like that. So I will give you a sign. Now, I gave the audience a choice of signs last night. We have various signs, and you have to tell me which one you prefer. We have the sort of, you know, the standard, give me one of these, you know. Okay, there's the sign. And then we have the ever-popular peace sign. And then, of course, there's this sign here. That's the one you want, right?
There's no speakers on the stage, and we're all wearing headphones,
right,
as everybody can see.
And usually in a session, we get to mix our own monitor.
or a headphone mix. We get to do that ourselves, whereas now you have a guy off the side doing it for us.
The idea of this album, at least this is my dissertation, this is what I'm telling myself, and you get to eavesdrop on it, is that I am not going to become an aging yuppie, if I can help it. And as long as I have the energy, I'm going to be a provocateur and a complainer and someone who tries to make things different than they are. Because, as everyone knows, things can always be better than they are. So the idea is, we're, you know, rather than get into this idea of like handing off the baton to another youthful generation, begrudgingly, as we would, we are going to participate hand in hand, all of us together, as one sort of like unified unit. Us and our children, we're going to break the cycle of survivalist, defeatist mentality and march forward into that brand new day of 1991.
I've never heard Todd sort of announce what his songs mean to an audience, and I thought that was pretty nice.
The only thing that you can guarantee to change, if it's possible to change that thing, is yourself. I mean, at least you have some control, well, you presume to have some control over that. And as long as you think that there's something about yourself you can change, then if you change that thing for the better, then you've made the world better. That's all that it takes to make the world better, is to make yourself a better person. It may not be measurable on the grand scale. It may not be like the entire population suddenly swerves to a different direction. But that's not the way things work anyway. People have to take it upon themselves to change the world by changing themselves. That's what the song is about.
An a cappella, we would sometimes ask him what this means, and he would just, you know, ignore us. In Nearly Human, when we started our sessions, he would tell everybody exactly what he was thinking or what the song was about, so that we would know and be able to give that kind of a performance. But if somebody were to ask him on the street, he wouldn't really comment.
We're rolling, right? Okay, one, two, one, two.